morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the special edition of Khmer Time Cross Talk. With us today, we have Mr. John Fion. Good morning, Mr. Fion. Nice to meet you. Thank you for spending time with us today. Mr. Fion is a founder and executive director of Invictus International School, who will be the new player in Cambodia's private education sector. So today, we are going to talk about the challenges, opportunities, and potential for Invictus International School in Cambodia. First of all, can you please tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. So I'm an entrepreneur, a serial entrepreneur. I've started a few businesses over the years. We started Invictus 4 years ago. And before that, I did tech entrepreneurship type of internet companies. I was able to list one of my companies on the Australian stock market. Small cap, but still a win. And I have a few other small businesses. But for right now, I'm just focused on Invictus and focused on growing Invictus.
Okay. So why Cambodia? Why you choose to expand your school to Cambodia?
So we expanded from Singapore first to Hong Kong. We did that last year. And we were looking at more locations. And so we thought Cambodian market, which is very vibrant, young, fast-growing market, which would allow us to have 100% ownership, was very attractive. And so we did some market research last year. We came and looked at locations, and we found something that worked for us, and we did the numbers, and it looked attractive, so we went for it.
So what would you say is the mission statement of Invictus International School in Cambodia? How would it set apart the school from other schools in Cambodia?
Sure. So we looked at the international, you know, we looked at the international school market here quite closely. We saw that while there were a lot of local private schools and international schools, we thought that a affordable, high-quality school, such as ourselves, would be attractive to local Cambodians as well as expats. And we also realized that we could set ourselves apart by being one of the first truly international schools in Phnom Penh. So if you look at the other international schools, they're very good, but how many of them actually have locations outside of Phnom Penh? How many of them actually have locations outside of Cambodia? And those are very few and far between.
Okay. But there are so many schools in Cambodia right now, like many. So how do you plan to build up your reputation in this country?
Sure. So the first thing that we do is we have an international curriculum, so British curriculum for primary school, IPC. Then we have Cambridge for our secondary school. And what we do that makes us different is that we charge $8,000 a year, which is a lot lower than what we consider our competition to be, which is the bigger schools, the schools that are more $15,000 to $25,000 a year, in that range. We give them a run for their money because the quality of our curriculum, the teachers, and some of the facilities. What I mean by some of the facilities, our classrooms, our environment that we teach in, is that of an international school standard. However, what we do to get that price point is we don't have swimming pools, we don't have big playing fields, we don't have big gymnasiums. However, we use outside public fields and outside public environments to do that kind of thing. And that's the model for all over the world. We always strive to be affordable, high quality education by stripping out what we consider to be nice to have, but not necessary to have in terms of teaching.
Can you go a bit more on that? I mean, when you start a business, you expect profits, of course.
Yes.
But how can you balance between profit and education quality?
Sure. So if you look at our teachers, our teachers are international school teachers. They come from the same pool of teachers that the international schools have. We don't skimp on the education side of the business. The education side of the business is core to us. So if you look at our results in Singapore, for instance, our grade threes and grade sixes get tested every year, and that's an international test against, and that's measured against other international schools. And our results so far have been that we've actually overachieved in that. So we've become, in terms of quality, we have one of the best schools academically. However, we don't claim to have the kind of facilities that those other schools have. So we don't have, as I said, the swimming pools or the... We have a small swimming pool in Singapore, and we'll strive to do something similar to that in Phnom Penh. But we don't have the Olympic-sized swimming pool. We don't have, you know, the football field of, you know, of a professional football team. You know, we will have playing areas, and we will be competitive, but that's how we save on the cost while we maintain the quality. I send my children to Invictus, and I would expect that anyone who does a school will eat their own dog food, as I say, in the business. You know, they'll live the brand, and I live the brand, and I'm very comfortable with what my children are getting, and I expect that will be exactly the same here in Phnom Penh.
Singapore is well known for its standard of education, like very high standards of education. Do you plan on bringing those to Cambodia?
Yes, so what we do in our curriculum is we have Singapore maths, which is one of the best in the world. So we'll have that in Phnom Penh. We will also have Chinese. So we'll be Mandarin, you know, speaking in a school. So we'll have three trilingual. So it'll be Khmer, English, and Mandarin. My children all speak fluent Mandarin. So I would hope that everyone else who comes to Invictus could potentially have that opportunity in the future to have their children be able to speak three languages fluently.
Okay. Speaking of curriculum, can you go a bit more on the teaching technique and methodology that you introduced at Invictus?
So we use, in primary school, we use IPC, which is International Primary School Curriculum. Okay. It's used in over 1,000 schools around the world. It's originally from the UK. The Shell company actually originally developed it for their expat students. And we've been using it now for the last 4 years. We're very comfortable with it. What we do with that curriculum is it's similar to IB in that it's learning based by doing versus by chalk, what they call chalk and talk, where you watch the teacher write something on the board and then you copy it down and then you study and you learn 10 things. This is more like a learn-based, inquiry-based learning, which is what an IB school does. So it's inquiry-based learning for our IPC environment. And then for Cambridge, it's a little bit more rigid because, unfortunately, we want to send our children to the best universities, and Cambridge, we believe, offers that opportunity. We also want to maintain a high standard of quality. And what you find in IB schools, and what people don't know about IB schools, is that every IB school is different. There is no one standard for an IB school. So with Cambridge, you have a standard that we know what you're going to get.
Can you tell us more about the locations that Invictus has chosen to set up its first school in Cambodia?
Sure. So we're in the middle of the middle of Phnom Penh.
Okay.
Yeah. I like to say we've landed ourselves right in one of the top areas of Phnom Penh, and it's an unusual, I think, for most people to have a school in a reasonably priced school in a prestigious area. And I would say if you look at our schools in Singapore and Hong Kong, we've done exactly that. We've always put our schools in nice environments,
okay,
where there's a good, attractive setting for students. At the same time, we've tried to find a balance with the numbers. So we've always tried to be very mindful of what parents want in terms of economic, you know, return for their money, in terms of a good quality education without paying for the what we call the frills. Yeah, so that's how we've overcome this every time, and I think if you look at our website, you'll be able to see our site is very attractive.
Okay, so with site locations, so who are your target when it comes to clients?
Sure, so we target middle and upper class citizens. What we find, at least in in Singapore and Hong Kong, and I think expecting in Cambodia, is if you are on an expat package, let's say, or someone else is paying for your education, that's fabulous. You're welcome to go to the $25,000 a year school, or whatever you choose. But if you're paying for your own schooling and you have more than one child, or you're just on a budget, then Invictus looks very attractive. And it looks attractive not because it's the cheapest school in Phnom Penh, but it looks attractive because if you look at the quality that we offer and the kind of education that we offer at this price point, you can't do better, in my opinion, because of the fact that it's proper international curriculum with international teachers. And what we offer on top of it, which no one else can offer, this is something unique to Invictus, is the ability to go from Phnom Penh to one of our other schools in the world. So it could be Hong Kong, it could be Singapore, it could be Australia, and we will help those students get student visas and get them to another country of their choosing to help them get into a university of their choosing.
Okay. You mentioned you have conducted market research here.
Yes.
What do you think about the current status of education in Cambodia?
So it's young. Like, for instance, I understand that some of the best schools here are actually nonprofits, mm-hmm. and there actually isn't a nonprofit law in Phnom Penh, in Cambodia. It's complicated, I'm sure. At the same time, we saw there are a number of new schools that have opened up recently, and there's been quite a lot of attention for those schools. We just saw that if you look at the markets, there really wasn't proper international brands such as ourselves that had moved in here. So Nord Anglia obviously has something here, I understand, but I think one school. But the big brands like Dulwich, et cetera, have not arrived here. And not that we compete with those schools, but we're like, the market does not seem to be full of international players like ourselves. They seem to be local, they seem to offer a good standard of education, but we do think we offer something different.
Okay, so what do you think is the biggest loophole here in Cambodia when it comes to private education?
Loophole?
Yeah.
I don't know. That's a tough question. I don't really think of a loophole. I think one of the things that we find different in Phnom Penh from Hong Kong or from Singapore, I'll give an example. In Hong Kong, I have to get 5 different licenses from 5 different government bodies. In Singapore, I think I need about 5 different licenses as well. Australia is a similar type of environment where you have to go through lots of government bodies. I think in Phnom Penh, I think I only need to go through 2 or 3. So it's just a few less licenses.
Okay. Do you think Invictus International School will be able to bring upon changes to Cambodia?
I hope that Invictus can be an example to other schools where they can see that it's not just about facilities. I mean, in Singapore, we have a number of copycats already.
Okay.
Obviously, they don't do it the same as us, but people have copied our model to provide education. And that's fine. I mean, look, at the end of the day, what you want to do is you want to support the overall market to give people the best education possible for them. And that's what we're looking to do. And I'm not jealous of other people competing with us or trying to improve their game. I think that helps everybody. And we're trying to improve our game every week and every day.
Okay. Apart from academic excellence, what are the qualities that you wish for your student to be equipped with?
So I'd love them to be resilient.
Resilient?
Yes. And that's something that comes down to our name. So if you look at Invictus and you ask, what's the reason for Invictus, the name? And Invictus means unconquerable. In Latin, the Latin meaning is unconquerable, which I take to be resilient. I would definitely say that we fight in the sense that we're business. We have to struggle every day to improve ourselves and to overcome difficulties. But we give it our all to be the best that we can be. And we don't give up. And we overcome.
How about the teacher and the school staff whom you have recruited? How professional they are, and how can they help you to fulfill your goal?
Sure. So we're recruiting all the time, but I looked at it. We looked at hundreds of CVs. Okay. For this opening, I believe we chose 1 out of 80 staff for this role. So we get a lot of CVs, and the reason we get a lot of CVs is we're actually a proper international school, so we're attractive to teachers all over the world. So people want to come here. We don't hire just anybody. We really are very thorough with who we choose and how we work with them. We're part of a much bigger group, which is called Chipeng Seng. And Chipeng Seng has a huge department with just lots of HR people. So we definitely get our fair share of CVs, and we are very careful about how we choose our teachers.
What do you hope to see in your students after they graduate from your school?
So I'm slightly different from other owners, I guess, in that I would really like them to be successful in life, not just academically.
Not just academically?
Yes. I think that one of the things that I see in the market is that schools tout their, so they promote their academic numbers. And so they say, I got so many A's, I got so many, you know, distinctions in terms of students. I don't think that's a true mark of success. And I'll tell you why. When I went to school, I didn't get an A.
Really?
No. I got average marks.
Average mark. What is it, A, B, C, D?
I was a C's and D's.
Okay.
I was never an academic overachiever. And I have friends who were academic overachievers and never achieved anything in life. So I don't see academic achievement as success in life. I would like people to be successful in life. And that's controversial, I understand. Obviously, I would like all our students to do well academically, to get into universities, to do well in life. But I don't see academic success as success in life. This is one difference from me, and maybe this is even different from my board, but this is my perspective on life, because I didn't do fabulously at school, academically wise, and then, you know, light up the academic field. You know, I have a brother who's doing his PhD at the moment, and he's 38 years old, and I don't know if he's doing so well. And my father has a PhD, and he works for me, or used to work for me. So, I don't think PhDs are a sign of success. No offense to my father. I love him very much. But I do really believe that we need to equip our students with the ability to be creative, to overcome difficulties, and to be resilient. These are the things that I think we really need to do. And creativity, for me, is something the heart of Invictus. One of the things that we do differently academically is we ask our teachers to be creative. And the reason we can do this is we're not prescriptive over how they teach. We ask them to teach the academic curriculum, but we don't enforce like a tick-boxing culture. And because of that, our teachers are more creative, which means that our children are more creative and happier. And I think that's the key in life, is happiness in what you're doing, because then you are truly excited about what you're busy with, and then you're ultimately successful.
Why creativity is so much important to your students? Why? Why is it so important?
Well, let's think about this, right? Like, where are all the jobs going in the future?
Okay.
They're going to artificial intelligence, right? And like, you know, many of the jobs, let's take like, you know, all the drivers in the world. Do you think we'll be driving cars in 20 years' time?
Probably not.
Probably not, right? So do you think the accountants will be doing the same job they're doing right now in 20 years' time?
Oh yeah, we got a lot of software right now.
So I think the accountants, I think the lawyers, I think everybody out there, all these jobs are coming under pressure from artificial intelligence, from technology, where they are being questioned beyond remembering things. They're being questioned beyond just knowing the answer. You know, what you need in this world now is creativity, the ability to outthink the machine, to put things together that the machines cannot put together. You know, taking two disparate ideas and being able to come up with something brilliant in the middle.
Okay. So when Cambodian parents send their children to your school, what can you tell them to expect from sending their children to your school, to Invictus International School?
So first thing that I'd like to expect is to have happy children.
Okay.
And I'd like them to have happy teachers. So I want happy teachers and happy children. The second thing I'd like them to do is to actually want to learn. My children were not really academically gifted. However, they are happy to learn. And now my daughter, who was struggling with English, is reading Harry Potter books all on her own, no problem, with no encouragement from the father or mother. There's no flogging of the getting the homework done. They're happy to do it on their own. That's the key, is you have to have children who want to be able to learn by themselves. And I hope that we do that. I'd like the children who come to Invictus to be happy, to want to learn, to want to improve, to want to build those skills, because those are the skills you need when you go into university. The ability to learn, to love to learn, to want to excel.
I want to go a bit deeper on this one. How can you make children to love to learn, but most of them do not like studying?
I can tell you this about my daughter.
Okay.
She said to me, "Dad, you own the school." I said, "Yes, I own the school." She said, "Dad, I want you to tell all the teachers they have no holiday." What more can I tell you? And this is not just my daughter. I can tell you that our children in the school want to come to school. They skip into school. They're happy. And I want that to be exactly the same for our school in Phnom Penh, exactly the same in our school in Hong Kong, in Australia, everywhere. Because when you have happy children, they want to learn. If you teach them correctly, they will inquire. They will ask for more. And that's the key.
Okay, so when will your first school open its door in Cambodia?
So we're hoping to open in early April this year.
Okay.
We've got most of our licenses already in terms of the taxes and the company registrations and everything else that you guys know about. Obviously, we're waiting on our final piece of the puzzle now in March,
okay,
which we expect to get sometime in the middle of March. You're welcome to come down and have a look at our facilities. We will be renovating till June. So that's the reason why we're offering the special discount, the special offer right now in March, $1,000. It's basically an application fee. Get free schooling for the next 3 months.
Wow.
And then you come to our school. And it's a fabulous deal. I don't think anyone will offer anything quite close. I was asked, isn't this sound like we're desperate? I'm like, no, we're not desperate. We just want to open the school, and we want to offer parents the best education possible for their children right now.
Okay. This is $1 million question. Do you expect your business to be successful in Cambodia?
Of course. I mean, we've invested millions and millions of dollars.
Okay.
We did not come to Cambodia and do it on the cheap. We did it on the expensive.
Okay.
And so we expect a good return.
Okay. So now you have an international school, but do you plan to go further than that, further beyond the school?
Of course, we'll look at kindergartens.
Okay.
And we own kindergartens in Singapore and Hong Kong, so we'll own kindergartens here as well. Yeah.
So
and then the question is, do you want to go to high universities, right? This is your next question. You want to know about universities. We just opened our secondary school this year, so you need to give me a few more years. But I have children, so, you know.
Okay. That's all for my questions. Now, I want you to talk to our viewers. What do you want to tell them? What messages do you have for them?
I really hope that you all can come and have a look at what we're doing at Invictus and see what we have to offer and the value that we can really bring to your children. I would like you to be part of our family, the Invictus family, and give your children the international education that they deserve, an international mindset, which is gonna allow them to go beyond Cambodia into the rest of the world. as well as the fact that I'd love them to learn Mandarin. It's part of my personal goal is for my children to speak Mandarin, and I hope that the Cambodians out there can share similar appetite for the language.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Fira.
It's
very nice conversation.
Appreciate that.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's all for our cross talk. See you next time.